we have done, our syntax analysis is done. Most cases it could be LALR or LR1 syntax analysis is done, and lexical analysis is done, tokens comes in. Now the semantic analysis begins. What is semantic analysis? It's the meaning of the your code, and here we call it this tree, we call it a loosely coupled in various books and question form, like parts tree. Some books say it's a syntax tree, more good term would be abstract syntax tree or annotated parts tree, annotated syntax tree. So all this basically the same. Parts tree, probably you come to the new automata class, there's a context free grammar, where it is not ambiguous and this grammar, then you think of the same grammar should from left to right only one parse tree. That we generally first introduce parse tree to you, but whenever in compiler codes we basically it is not, we generally more define the parse tree's abstract syntax tree, that is the your operation goes to a node and your leaf will be your operands. So that is a better term. So here the problem with this, that semantic analysis, you have to not only in your tree, you not only into variable, you have to put your values also. So you can think of, say, in your top-down parsing, say your stack is contains only the terminals and variables, but whenever the semantic analysis is done, the values also will be there. See, top-down parsing, it is simple. It is the until you only put terminals and variables into the stack, and at the end it is vanished because end of stack. But in the LR1 parsing, we generally think of maybe one stack or two stack. If you do one stack, the terminals and variables, and before that state. A state comes, a state gives the picture what is within the stack. And remember, whenever you are putting the value into it, there will be three values. The value at that particular variable or terminal. So you can think of a single stack with three values or three different stack. I generally done three different stack by implementation, but it is implementation different. Remember that right now in semantic analysis, syntax analysis, you check the syntax only, but the values to put in and whether that is legal values or not, on the left hand side, that is to be checked by the semantic analysis. So that is much easier. Okay, and then in the same process, after this checking and all this thing, intermediate code generator, I have to do why you are going for intermediate code, because nowadays you are developing a code, a particular, you are not developing a code, a particular machine, you do not know which machine it will work on. So it may be most possibly a virtual machine. So it is better to intermediate code generator, and then ultimate code generator will be depend on the target machine. And code optimization may be at two places. Here it can be, and here it can be. So we'll discuss about these things later. So this is the grammar. Say E is equal to E plus T, E is equal to E minus T, E to T. This is the grammar. T can be 0, 1, 2, T is a say integer. So we have to calculate like that. Say here the values will be 3, and here 2, 3 plus 2, 5, and minus 4. Ultimately, it will be 1. So whenever we are doing the syntax tree, we are not putting the value, but when the semantic tree, we are actually putting value into it. And we all know that in computer, we generally do by infix analysis, and computers do the postfix. Mostly it is true, because but you can argue that why don't we try in your day-to-day mathematical work or programming work in a postfix, that people would love hating the programming. The programming should be as friendly as possible, because human minds are different, and computers still now the computers, whatever we have designed, it's different. Here in fix notation we are very friendlier, and computer is much better in the postfix notation, but they can easily calculate on the stack, and the top of the stack is always a value. So ultimately our objective would be that eval should be E1 val, like this is E1, E1 T val, the value, and this is a concatenation operation, the double and the plus. So this is a postfix notation. It is a infix notation here, and it is a postfix. Most all of compiler does this a postfix notation. And another thing I must tell you, if it's a bottom-up parsing, you know, it will be all, we have told you two kinds of attribute, actually synthesized attribute, and another is LEL, L for left inherited attribute. The bottom-up parsing is a good point, and another, all the terminals should have only synthesized attribute, no inherited attribute. Terminals, whatever you see the terminals, all are synthesized attribute, and various variables or non-terminals in a grammar, they can have both, so inherited and synthesized. And in bottom-up parsing, the good point is this synthesized attribute are pronounced, and always you know the various kinds of tree travels. One is top-down tree traversal, another is bottom-up tree traversal, and it's a post order. Your root come at the end. In bottom-up parsing, it is a bottom-up post order. That means your order should come at the end. And in top-down parsing, it is a pre-order tree traversal. So, in bottom-up parsing, if your parser, most of the grammars is bottom-up parsing, either LR1 or LLR1, it would be much simpler. What I have told till now, that symbol, your lexical analysis give you tokens, and now your syntax analysis portion, OKD, yeah, it's a valid tokens, and they give also a abstract syntax tree. Now, you are putting the values into the abstract syntax tree, and getting the values. Actually, you are getting the values. Because why? Though it is, it can be done at the ultimate code, but it will be done at this stage for during the intermediate code generation for dummy checking whether there is any semantic error or not. So these valuation will be not be final valuation of an expression and all, because that would be done actually whenever you are running the code optimization first stage, and then code optimization at the target machine, then it will be done whenever you are running the code. But here we are doing it after the syntax analysis is okay. We are putting value and check that whether it is actually okay or not. That means whether it is semantically correct or not. Semantic means meaning. Syntax means rules. Rules may be okay, but semantics may be not, because you know whenever you add most of the programming rules, a floating point number, add with integer number, it will result in floating point number, and left hand side a string, many programming in languages object it. Maybe PHP will accept it, because you know PHP, JavaScript, they generally have very little type checking, but C, Java very statically type checked, Python is a dynamic type check, they will give a runtime exception, and C and Java will raise error when a compilation phase. Okay, so these are the semantics checking. Now where we are, I again repeat that terminals only should be synthesized attribute, and any variable or non-terminal can have both attributes. One is inherited attribute, and we call it we can call it L from left inherited, and we can call it right inherited, right, but never you see the right inherited, always left inherited. That means definition comes from left to right, not right to left. So here also you see the predominance of the L here, like your LL1 parsing, LR parsing, or LLR parsing. L is pronounced here, that means inheritance comes from either parent or siblings from left to right, not right to left. Okay, so now if it LL1 parsing is a top down parsing, pre-order, top down always LL1 parsing pre-order. When the semantic analysis is also done, it's a pre-order. It is a more inherited attribute will be taken care of, but there will be always a collision between inherited attribute, because all variables can have inherited attribute and also synthesized attribute. So there will be rules which will be dictated between inherited attribute and synthesis attribute comes from bottom up. But for LR1 parsing, it is always a bottom up and the post order. That means your root of the tree comes at the end, and there is synthesis attributes are more pronounced. Okay. Now, this particular chapter, chapter 5, you have to read the chapter. They read the chapter, the syntax directed translation by our lab. I am following this book, and or in some books, there's very good books. I have also given you this book also. They K.T. Cooper and Linda Torgerson. That book, it causes context sensitive analysis. It's the same thing. This context sensitive analysis, don't confuse with context sensitive grammar at all. This is, I found this is good name, context sensitive analysis. This means you are now see the your syntax tree with the putting value. It's in which context it is, whether it program in where it is. So it is a context sensitive analysis, also good name. Syntax directed translation also good name. And I have told you variable and not a little, L means left. Synthesized is typically for LR parsing. In this diagram, I already told that this one, this particular string, this you can feel it is a semantic tree. So any abstract syntax tree, maybe with all, because these are basically at the node you are seeing, it is a basically not a simple node. It is a basically a pointer and with some values. It's a maybe one dimensional pointer, like here, here E should be E, and here it enter 3, it is an integer, and like this. And where to put it to the pointer, this pointer will be there. So it basically consists of a array like thing, and it consists. So this particular string, it is a post evaluation, then this will be there, because at the whenever we are syntax tree, and then whenever to make the code faster, you know that in Java, C++, to make the code faster, this will be calculated at the compile phase itself. Actual value will be at the runtime, but it will be checked. Okay. But for Python, it will be dynamically checked, because all these rules and these things, that will Python become a bit slower, but it is a good glue type language backend. But anyway, this is a particular string, this string, second packet opening and eval. This is a concatenation operation eval, and this plus comes here, that is a postfix notation. It will be added here, this will be added here, like here, which is with val. The E1 val is 3, T val are 2, and then the plus comes, all this will be there at the root after the calculation of this. Yeah. See, I'm taking this governor record. This is, we'll be checking the variable scoping rule. See, this scoping rules, it cannot be checked by your syntax tree. So it has to be checked by your table. That means you have a table that is called symbol table. And remember, the symbol table is not a single table, it consists of several table, because you know this symbol table is always accessed during the scanning or lexical analysis phase, then the syntax analysis, semantic analysis, intermediate code generation, then subsequent later. So it cannot be a single table, it basically consists of multiple tables. It generally every scope, every function at its own symbol table, and you know the variables within a scope of same name with different scope of a different meaning. So it will be symbol table is a consist of tables, and it generally done by the hashing, hash table concept, like dictionary concept in your Python. This kind of thing can be done, and it is a consist of a table. So all these things cannot be LR parsing. So it cannot be solved by this LR parsing. Most of these rules are governed by inherited attribute. So that is very important. Whenever in C and Java we declare int i1 comma i2 i3 equal to 5 semicolon, that means we are giving the inherited attribute to i1 as int, integer, I2 is integer. It is not a synthesized attribute, it's inherited attribute. Most of the variables in the C, Java language, this kind of static languages, are inherited attribute. In Python, some are not. Okay. So these are all inherited. There is a scoping rules and everything. It is done here in semantic semantics. This is very the one way I've told you, but we maybe have a graph, and whether you have to see graph, we will see that whether there should not be loop in a graph, is it acyclic graph, we'll see that in subsequent today. We will discuss this. This is dynamic checking, and see here basically. Remember, this intermediate code generation and semantic analysis cannot be together. So after the abstract syntax tree output, this parse tree is nothing but abstract syntax tree or annotated syntax tree or annotated parse tree, syntax tree, annotated parse tree, annotated syntax tree. So in various ways, four or five names. But anyway, it is not a simple parse tree. It's abstract syntax tree. Then first the semantic analysis, you put the dummy values from this and check it, and then the intermediate code generation comes. The intermediate code generation comes. It is not parallel. Okay. So, synthesized attribute and the inherited attribute. Synthesized terminal at the parse tree node, N is defined as semantic rule associated with the production and N. Note that the production must have A at its end, obviously. It is a synthesized means you cannot synthesize from top down, it can be synthesized from bottom up. So that is the reason synthesis A at its end. That is the meaning. It synthesized node defined only in terms of attribute values of the children N and X. Then no issues. The bottom up parsing that is fantastic, but top down parsing then it will be a little bit difficult. Inherited attribute. And that will say in bottom up parsing, your error. Any error in your program, it can be caught earlier because everything is bottom up. See, this is attribute. Inherited attribute for a non-terminal, because inherited attribute cannot be a terminal, non-terminal. At parse tree node N is defined by semantic rule associated the production of the parent of the node. It must have a symbol in the node. That's true. And we'll see. It is not much of an issue. These are the production rules. This is. You can define these production rules, and it's basically a top-down parsing, and then this is semantic rules. Definitely, these are the, I think, evaluating the statement. I'm taking all this from books. Yeah, this is we can stay a little bit. This is a, I'm taking the particular page number, that is the reason I put it, so you can go back to book and see it if any confusion. Yeah, nothing. Lexical values is come, 3 comes, this 3 comes, which is calculated 3 star 4 plus 3, 4, remember in here, whenever we say L means is a inherited, okay, this is inherited, it is a inherited attribute, maybe top down, but ultimately it will be, values will come. Then the it will dictate the there will be always a terminals I have told you is always synthesized, and a variable can have both the inherited attribute and the synthesis attribute. So there will be the semantic rules which rule to be finalized later, or maybe portion of some of the rules. We'll check it. And this is very important, dependency graph. A dependency graph depicts the flow of information among the attributes, instances in particular parse tree, and each from one. So this is all are side by side after the syntax analysis done, or during the syntax analysis. Maybe for some good compilers, they always draw the dependency graph. It is very vital. The lots of short notes may come if it's offline exam. So you should know this name. What is dependency graph? Like here. E, the production E1 plus T, then eval definitely E1 and E2. So here it will come, this is dependency graph, it is like this. Annotated parse tree of 3 star 5, here 3 is a synthesized, 5 is a synthesized. Say it is a, say here you can see it here, T dash is inherited attribute, and synthesized attribute is 50 because it will multiply. So at both end we have ultimately value is 15. It is the f dot val digit length. This is synthesized, the m3 comes, this f val 5 digit 5, then star operation here, then it comes synthesized 3 into 5 15. Here T1 dash 15 synthesized in it, both are 15. So this is a kind of a graph, and dependency graph should draw by the semantic analysis, and there should not be in a loop, because if there is in a loop, you agree that there will be always a time consumption. So there should not be there's a routines are available to check whether in a loop is there or not in a graph. Graph should be a directed graph, and there should be. Yeah, the same thing I have shown it here. Dependency graph of annotated parser 5.5. This is the graph. This is how the value goes. This is the value goes. The directed graph. I've always told you like it is. We always left to right here, and it goes to like bottom up. Here it goes. This is it. And this is not tough at all. L attribute definitions, I have told, it is a L means left and it's inherited. Inherited means it is comparent or by the your older siblings, that is your left from child to, it can process to right, left to right. Yes, the rules like this, inherited attribute, dependency graph, here important dependency graph idea, ultimately it will be real. These are integer, ultimately it will be coerced float. So this is also, I taken the book from this. So this is you can show it is a L inheritance. Say it is forced upon this, so from the siblings. So this is L inheritance. Not, it is not synthesized in L inheritance. Applications of syntax directed translation. Here the last two lines is very important. The first, the is attribute definition is suitable for use during bottom up parts. That I am telling again and again, is for synthesized. Applicable during bottom up parts. The second L is suitable for using top down. Left attribute inherited to top down parsing. These are two ideal, and I have told that most of the parsing nowadays is bottom up LR, LR1 and LLR. So synthesized attribute is very useful there. So you see why you will go for bottom up. A lot of advantages in semantics you are getting it. Here it is basically syntax tree. It is basically top down parsing. Check it. Like I have told you, because all nodes consist of this kind of thing, operation and operand and all these pointers here like this, all these things are like this. It is not a single space. This is, you can see, recognize this is typical top down parsing, because whenever you see this kind of thing, E-dash, definitely we have done it for avoiding of left recursion. So definitely it is a top, it is made for top down parsing. We have taken from the house book, and these are the semantic rules. Definitely, because we dash inherited is a T naught. These are the semantic rules, inherited, because it's a top down parsing. And it's same thing with the example with these rules in top down parsing, how the calculate A minus 4 plus C comes. This is this particular rule like 4, I have told again and again, this cannot be inherited, this is synthesized. But here ultimately it will be because the top down, it will be partly dictated by synthesized and partly inherited. This is one interesting, this is a very good example of inherited attribute of a array declaration. Say we are, whenever declare array in C or in Java, like int 2, 3. In C, typical can be read as array of two arrays of three integers. So that is ill-attributed grammar. The correspondence of array 2 and 3 is represented by this. This is cannot be synthesized. So this is a type expression of the this thing. Syntax directed, one is syntax directed definition in as per Aho's book, then comes the syntax directed translation. Typically, syntax directed translation SDT are implemented during parsing without building a parse tree. In this section, we focus on the use of SDTs to implement two important class of SDT, syntax directed definition. The underlying grammar is LR parsable and the SDT is S attributed, that I am telling again and again. And underlying grammar is LL parsable, then it is L attributed. But it is always inherited attribute will be consulted, but bottom up parsing, it is more or less S attributed. We shall see that in both the cases, the semantics rules in SDT can be covered into syntax directed translation, SDT translated with action that is executed at the right time. During parsing, an action in the production body is executing axonus, all the grammar symbols to the left hand action has been matched. Yeah, that is always, whenever it is matched, it is always checked with that. This is first in syntax directed definition, we know synthesized and L attributed, and then comes syntax directed translation, then we covered syntax graph, dependency graph. Dependency graph should be there because there should not be cycle. So here also it is again mentioned terminal symbols can have synthesized attributed computed by lexicon but not in it. That is true. And this I have covered in a diagram. A parse tree plus the value of its attributes is equal annotated. I sometimes annotated parse tree, abstract syntax tree, or so, but it is not a simple parse tree. Parse tree come across only whenever you are in our automata class, in context-free grammar or regular grammar, we come across parse tree, but from in compiler course, we believe parse tree is nothing but is annotated parse tree or abstract syntax tree. So, intermediate code generation starts after that, after the if semantic analysis is okay, we know if you bottom up parsing, it is good that mostly are synthesized attribute. If there is some inherited attribute, but in any case, there will be some inherited attribute. Say in Java and C, you have declared the variable, so definitely that variable is inherited attribute and function and all. All this checked with the symbol table. Intermediate code generation I have covered. So today, what we have covered today we start, it is as soon as your synthetic code is done, your parsing is done, it always put into values into it and check it. See, yes, you can say we can do it at runtime. No, it is basic, it can be done also your testing case also, so that it will not produce exceptions in your runtime. So that is a semantic check. And if then you consider the how to the values, like in top-down parsing, you can put the values into the stack along with the variables or terminals. Then it takes two positions. In bottom-up parsing, LR1 parsing, you always know that it always, if you think of a single stack, it is all the terminal variable and upon it a state. Then if you can think of another position, that is a your value, actual value. But it all will be calculated after the syntax analysis is done. Here I want to mention one major point that we have still had not touched today. So another two points we have touched, that the pre-order traversal and post-order traversal in a tree. For bottom-up parsing, they definitely on post-order traversal, and that is help that it will be mostly synthesized attribute. Terminals are always synthesized attribute, but variables synthesis attribute automatically come. But some cases, like in whenever some declarations in there in your program, that it inherited to override. So, in bottom-up parsing is basically synthesized attribute, and in top-down, it is a pre-order traversal, not post-order. In it will be part by unitary attribute and also synthesis attribute. Both these cases for variables, for terminals, for both the cases it will be synthesis attribute. Now we come to the infix notation to postfix notation. You know all the computers is more friendly to the postfix notation. Then you have a semantic tree that I mentioned, that always variables will be, say 3 plus 2 will be converted 3, 2 plus. This thing will be associated. That is, I have covered by posterior traversal. Already context sensitive analysis or semantics, all the SDTs, semantic analysis, we have covered. Then the intermediate continuation we have already started. Then the all the other subsequent parts, the target code generation and optimization technique will be followed, along with our distinct that what we have not done till yet, the actual presentation of LR1 and LLR1, give the actual examples on how to handle error when the error is coming in your parsing, how to handle it. Remember always, because we in computer science, we do not believe in backtracking. So error handling, the major rules would be your input string where you, with a look ahead, definitely we are not doing LR0 or LL0 parsing. We always can look ahead only one. And whenever you are seeing a look ahead and the top of the stack in top down parsing, it is not matching, or in the bottom up parsing, the stack state and it is not matching, then definitely some error. So, and your parsing table, that portion is blank, then you can put individual error routine there. And we should not go beyond when the error comes in input. We should not go then on the right, because at that point we are facing error. So we'll stick to that. We should not go on the left because we don't believe in backtracking. So we are facing there error in input there. In top-down parsing, we have seen that actually that portion is vanishes. That is not that. Actually, we're shifting pointer always left to right in both the cases, top-down and bottom-up. We are always getting left to right, and whenever you are facing error for as say LL1 parsing table or LR1 parsing table with look ahead, then we should see the stack position, and we may remove some of the elements there, and we try to go on. Because we should not stop only with only one error, we should not stop the parsing. Most of the cases in top-down parsing or bottom-up parsing, we try to solve any more distinct error. Maybe you know that in a programming in C and Java, if you make a single error, if you miss semicolon one place, it may generate subsequent errors. But nowadays, the parser or board error handling is more sophisticated. They will warn you that you have not only the error that you have missed semicolon, but they try to get it some other errors into your already digested code. And what portion of digested in bottom up parsing, the digested portion will be in the stack, undigested in on the your input portion. So the separate errors should be calculated, and these error routine should be their unfilled position of your parsing table, whether top down or bottom up. So we'll go into this, how different kinds of errors can be handled, and that will be your I request you to take the CA4 presentation, this error handling and the all the other repeating issues. So say compiler design is a basically gate topic. It's absolutely gate topic.